I'm Jenness Cortez. Today, let's talk about my painting, Vermeer, Master of Light. In considering titles for this painting, it occurred to me that the real subject of this master's works is light, no matter what face or what object that light describes. Most of Vermeer's paintings depict a particular light. It's the light that falls gently into his studio from a window that's set slightly above eye level. The character of that light is consistently cool, diffused, and honest. And his skill at portraying it is so convincing that the viewer of his paintings is made to feel an integral part of the domestic scenes that it illuminates. In my own painting, I wanted to honor his mastery of that light and chose to display three examples of it. I present them as objects, three framed paintings against a wall. And in another allusion to the subject of light, the arrangement is anchored by a decidedly artificial light source, a modern-day electric lamp. The most dominant of the three Vermeer paintings I've shown is, in actuality, the smallest. Measuring just 9 by 7 inches, Girl with a Red Hat, now in the collection of the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., is a little gem that commands our attention in a big way. With breathtaking economy of means, the painter has put us in the presence of an engaging young woman whose spectacular red hat, brimmed with Vermeer's beautiful light, casts a shadow over most of her face. But her eyes are alive in that shadow. She returns our gaze directly and appears about to speak. This same striking effect is seen in the better-known Girl with a Pearl Earring, which is the second painting on the wall. In the third Vermeer, The Allegorical Art of Painting, the artist is shown seated at his easel in the act of honoring the past, a role I can certainly identify with. This is one of the largest and most complex paintings in his small body of work, and its details are all carefully chosen. He shows himself dressed in a costume that was already antique in 1666. And his model is surrounded by symbols of the arts and of history. The artist, shown faceless here, is not just a self-portrait of Johannes Vermeer, but an instrument in the creation of the culture in which he lives. Vermeer was clearly conscious of his role as a shaper of reality, not just as its reporter. That insight, however, could not save him from financial difficulties. He sold very few paintings during his lifetime and was often in debt as he struggled to feed his large family. Buying and selling art and antiques provided much of his livelihood, and his mother-in-law, also a dealer, owned some of the many paintings that appear in his work. It's likely that his business interests explain how the enormous map that appears in The Art of Painting came into his hands. That map on the studio wall was already old enough and rare enough to be considered a collector's item when this painting was made. It chronicles Dutch maritime ventures that opened new trade with Asian countries, especially China. The source of the Ming Dynasty enameled moon flask I've placed on the tabletop. That imported flask holds two tulips, symbols that still instantly remind us of Vermeer's beloved homeland and its so-called golden age. His quiet portrayals of Holland's ordinary moments, as he saw them in the revealing light of that window in Delft, are timeless reminders to us to look and to look again with new attention. Not just to see what we call art, but to find beauty in the everyday with our own fresh eyes. I hope you'll join us again soon for another episode of Demystifying the Masters.
If you enjoyed this episode of Demystifying the Masters with Jenness Cortez, like it, share it, and subscribe to our channel. If you are an art collector planning to enhance your collection, we invite you to view more of the Cortez work at jennescortez.com.